Hi, I'm Dr. Gina Mackenzie, host of the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, the educational channel of the Community College of Philadelphia. Tonight we have with us Nate House. Nate is an assistant professor at the college and he's been with us since 2007. He has a BA in journalism from Temple University and an MA in creative writing also from Temple University. Nate has been the crime and courts reporter at the Philadelphia Tribune. His work has been published extensively in the Pebble Lake Review, Carve Magazine, Sententia Magazine, the Chesapeake Bay Review, Rider Magazine, Armchair Shotgun, and Apt, which is forthcoming this month, January 2012. He's written for the Philadelphia Inquirer, the Boston Globe, and the Chicago Review, and tonight is here with us to read from his novel, Float, which was published in 2011. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure. So, being a writer means working with words. What is it about words that makes you want to be their coworker?
Well, I think it's not just words, and I mean, I love all words, but I think it's the written word that is the most appealing to me, because I think the written word, in some ways, gives power not only to the reader, but also, I mean, not only to the writer, but I think to the reader as well. And writing and reading fiction, I think, to me, is a magical thing where sometimes if you're in front of an audience, you know, and you're speaking or you're acting, it's just not the same as having that time and that, I think, intensity of sitting down and writing it and trying to make something real that is completely unreal. And so that's the thing that appeals to me, is that it's making magic, things that can't exist, making them real.
All right, so you sort of mentioned three words that really struck me. Mm-hmm. The idea of magic, the idea of power, and the idea of intensity. Do those three things connect for you as a writer?
I think they do. The intensity part for me is in the working. And even when I'm reading, if it's something that's hard to read, there is a certain intensity there that I really do equate to to physical exertion. I mean, when you when you're on the basketball court and you've just played for 45 minutes, you leave it all on the floor. And I think when you're done your 2-hour writing session or hour writing session, it's done. You're exhausted. And you should be. And if you've done it with the right amount of intensity, you've created something out of nothing but your own imagination and paper and ink, and that's, you know, and that's the magic. I think the other part about magic, though, is doing this. Fiction, I think, fiction and sometimes art, but I don't know art that well, so I only know fiction, but I imagine it's possible in art. In fiction, you can tell the truth that can't be told in any other way. Good art does that too. Abstract art does that, and that's my goal is to tell the truth through something that is completely made up.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about work and the hard work that it is to be a writer.
Right.
What kind of experience do you want for your readers in that? Should it be intense and difficult for them to get through, or should it be more magical?
Well, I think for this book, Float, it should be intense, right? It should definitely be an intense and difficult read. But for other things, like columns that I do for, you know, either the Inquirer or the Boston Globe or Chicago Tribune or something like that, that's easy. You know, I mean, that's funny. I like to be a funny, low-key person. But for fiction, my fiction tends to be very dense, very heavy. And I am challenging the reader with this particular novel and with some of the short stories I've written. And other ones are real easy, you know. I wish I could make them easier. And I'm trying to make a novel right now that I think is going to be easier to read. But what's funny to me is that it's just as difficult for me to write a difficult novel to read as it is for me to write a novel that's easier to read. The writing is still just as difficult.
It's sort of like maybe the actor's perspective that comedy is more difficult than straight drama or than tragedy.
Yeah, I think comedy is the most difficult thing to write, definitely. There are some lines in here that are kind of funny, but funny in like, I can't believe that's funny type of way. I mean, it's dark, and some of it really surprises me and scares me.
What are some of the risks that you take then as a writer, knowing that you're writing a novel that's going to be difficult going for the audience?
Well, one of the things you risk is not being published. This novel took 8 years to get published, and it went through two agents. It went through all the major houses. Parts of it are written in the second person point of view, which is very difficult. And you know,
deadly. We always tell our students never to do that, right?
Right. Yeah. We always say never write in the second person. There's portions written in the second person point of view. There are sections that are written in the past perfect verb tense. You know, never do that. Start at the beginning and end at the end. It does not start in the beginning. It's not end at the end. And I don't want to write like that, actually. I think that's difficult. That's a big burden on the reader. But one of the things is that the story being told, right, the story that you came up with, and this is where I think that magic part comes in. If you create the plot and the characters in an intense way where you're working with them every day, they're going to tell you how the story needs to be told. And if they say it needs to be told with a shifting point of view from first person to second person in a present tense to past perfect verb tense, you have to do it. And you won't get published for it. But, I mean, hopefully it's a better story.
Can you talk a little bit about that publishing process, especially for our audience out there who might be trying to do some of the same things? Right.
It's tough out there. In some senses it's really tough, and in a lot of senses it's a lot easier than it has been. It's tougher in the sense right now that you have only like 10 major publishers that are controlling the majority of the blockbuster releases. They operate by what's called a blockbuster mentality, meaning that they're not going to look at your book, they're not going to take your book unless it's guaranteed that it's going to sell tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of copies. So that makes it difficult, because if it's not a blockbuster, if they don't think it's a blockbuster, they're not going to take it. The blockbusters that we read, some of them, we have no idea why they are blockbusters. The example that I always use in my classes, some people love it, and I don't want to insult anybody, but Marley and Me is a horrible book. It's a horrible book.
It's a horrible book.
Okay, I feel so bad now for saying that about somebody's book. But it's a bestseller. It's a blockbuster mentality.
There's a cute dog. Sell.
So, write about cute dogs is the message there. In that sense, it's difficult. But then we also have, because of the internet, we have, you could publish your own book now if you wanted to. You could put it online, on a blog you could write a book. So you can get published that way. Small publishers right now are using print on demand, right, which allows them to publish, to take risks that they wouldn't normally take. So what happens is, instead of having to pay their printer, for 10,000 copies, because the more copies you make, the cheaper it is, you have the technology to only print a book when somebody orders a book. So that's what Float is, essentially, is that my publisher, she printed a couple copies when it first came out, but then now it doesn't get printed until you order it. So there's a lot more opportunity right now. It's still really, really hard, though, I think.
I want to take us back for a few minutes to the first time that you discovered that you wanted to be a writer. Do you remember that moment?
I don't really remember that moment, because I think I've always been a writer. I've always written. I've always read. Books were as a kid were my favorite things. Certainly. I mean, they were, I had toys, I guess, but it was always books, and I wrote books. From like the age of 5 or 6. I think my first one was about a leprechaun. I think it was a bad leprechaun too. So I always wrote. What's the difference between always writing and being a writer? I don't think much, but I didn't really take it seriously until take it seriously as a career, as something that I thought I could be successful at, until I dropped out of one college in Colorado and then came back to Philadelphia to study journalism. And then once I took some journalism classes, and some of my professors, gave me some tips on where to get some newspaper articles published, then I said, I can really make a living doing journalism, and I can write fiction on my own time. So. I was more that I knew that I could make a living being a journalist, which is why I studied journalism.
Why the MA then?
The MA was because what happened was I worked at the Philadelphia Tribune for 2 years as a journalist. I had some pieces of fiction published there, and I loved that job. That was the best job I ever had besides teaching. It doesn't pay a lot. Journalists understand that when they get into the business that you don't make a lot of money.
And teaching does.
Yeah. Well, teaching, I make more as a teacher now than I did as a journalist, but yeah. We're certainly not in it for the money. So I went from the Tribune, I went to a public relations firm, basically so that I could work for the public relations firm half-time and then focus on freelance writing and fiction writing half-time. And because public relations paid more, I could do that. I didn't like public relations. Not that public relations as a career is bad, but for me, it's just not what I like to do.
Sure.
So I quit that, and I got a job at a Lotto. It's called Lotto People Magazine. And what it does is it celebrates the beauty of playing the lottery. And they paid good money. I made some good money, made some good friends. They fired all their writers 6 months after we were hired. So what I did was, after that, is I collected unemployment and wrote a lot, and I really liked it. But I also understood that my writing, at least my fiction writing, was not polished. It wasn't good enough. So that's what made me want to go to Temple to get the MA in creative writing. I needed help. You know, so.
Great. Mm-hmm. Well, and certainly we are hopefully about to hear all the help that
yeah.
gave you, mm-hmm. because the novel's fantastic, and I know our audience at home would love to hear some of it.
Okay,
so
great.
So could you share with us
sure.
now?
Sure. As an introduction, this novel takes place on a Caribbean island after a man has been at sea on a life raft for 18 days. And what happened was he was on a boat with his wife. He arrives on shore, his wife doesn't. So that's pretty much the mystery. The second part of the book takes place in Death Valley after he has gone home from the Caribbean island and pretty much been cleared of any crimes. He finds himself in Death Valley. And in both places, he's haunted by his ex-wife. Or I guess ex in the sense that she's dead. So here we go. Chapter 1. Each morning they come, formal and serious, into my white hospital room. I hear their marching footsteps from down the hall and know their metered steps will not end until the men stand at attention at the side of my bed. My heart begins to beat faster when I hear them coming. By the time they reach me, it is beating like a piston, and I struggle to think of answers for the questions I know they will ask. Three dark faces stare down at me, crisp white captain hats with shiny black visors sitting atop their perfectly postured heads. They wear tailored, dark blue shirts across broad chests, decorated with small medals over the breast pockets, and a small cloth reproduction of their island's flag embroidered on the sleeve. They have small metal guns, cleaned so many times they almost look blue, sticking out of polished leather holsters at their hips. Their arms hang straight down from their shoulders. Beautifully manicured fingernails rest just inches away from the end of the bed. The one in the middle is the tallest, and obviously the one in charge. The one to his right is shorter, but stockier. The one to his left wears expensive, wire-rimmed glasses and looks more like a uniformed librarian than an island policeman. The man in charge speaks in French, the one to his left translates, and the one to his right never says a thing. Slowly, I'm beginning to understand what the tall one says in his island French before it is translated. For the past 3 days, the conversation has been more or less the same, but I wait for the translator to reproduce most of the conversation anyway. Protocol and formality seem important here. The one in charge speaks with little emotion, his eyes focused only on the empty wall directly in front of him, and I am beginning to doubt the credibility of the translator. He speaks with a soft accent of sincerity and caring I do not sense from his superior. Bonjour, the one in charge says. Bonjour, I say to him. Are you comfortable? Asks the translator. Very. The man in charge deepens his voice, stands straighter, and looks directly at the empty wall instead of looking at me. How many in the boat? The translator asks, immediately interpreting the other's question. Deux, I tell him. The U.S. Coast Guard and various portmasters across the Atlantic have records that there were two people in the boat when it last left shore. How many in the life raft? Asks the translator. I do not answer. There are no records of how many people were in the raft, only records as to how many made it to shore. Where is she? Hanging from the ceiling of the room, a wooden fan slowly turns as they do in scenes from old movies that take place in the tropics. I never understood why the blades turn so slowly in such a hot climate, but now, underneath one, in the heat of the lower latitudes where nothing moves unless you are close to the sea, I find comfort just watching the passing of the blades. They create no breeze, but their movement implies that the room is cooler because of their existence. I don't know, I tell them. This is the third time they've asked this inevitable question, and the third time I have given them my lazy answer. Dead? The translator asks. I close my eyes and my mind returns to the place I lost you, the deep blue sea. It travels back to the place you returned, the bright orange life raft. I once again feel the miles of harmonious waves rocking the raft as if it were a cradle, before returning to the question. Dead, it sounds like an accusation. Eventually they leave. Their crisp black boots strike the white polished floor in unison as if the three were one. They have become impatient, I know, because they have changed tactics and only sent the kind translator today. You know why I'm here, he asks. Yes. We need an answer. There are films to fill out. The consulate needs to know. I understand. Here, he says, and hands me a black and white notebook and a pen with the name of the island written along the side of it. Please write clearly. He places his black and pink hand on my shoulder and gives it a light squeeze. He smiles in what seems like sympathy and walks out the door. The fan slowly turns, creating its imaginary breeze. The open window in front of me reveals a lush green forest filled with rubber leaves, their convoluted patterns interrupted only by red hibiscus flowers. We are far inland, away from the sea, but I still hear it and taste the salt and sand beneath my tongue. After what happened, I will always hear it, taste it, and feel it beneath me. They want to know where you are, dead or alive. They are suspicious that two left and one came back. They want some sort of confession on paper that will document how I came alone on a raft to the shore of their island paradise. So I begin to write my confession in an effort to understand when and where you actually left me. And as nice as my hosts have been, this confession isn't for them. I write it for you and me, hoping we can come to some sort of peaceable closure and put this entire horrible incident behind us. Should I read more?
Why don't we talk a little bit about that first?
Okay.
And then we would love to hear more.
Okay.
What inspired this novel?
This is basically a story that I wrote for one of my first creative writing classes at Temple as an undergraduate. And I had heard that stories from my parents that one of the biggest fights they got into was on a raft when they were snorkeling in Bermuda. So what I did was, the original story was called Offshore Separation, where a couple got divorced at sea. And the man actually left the life raft and swam back to shore and just kind of ditched her in the middle of the ocean. So that story got an F in creative writing.
So, sorry to hear that, but it's turned into something magnificent.
Yeah.
So the next passage that we're going to hear is later in the novel, right?
Yeah, the next passage is later on when he's in Death Valley. The majority of the scenes on the life raft, basically when the boat goes down and he's on the life raft, he's hallucinating, some would say, or he's actually seeing it, others would say. But on the raft, he is visited by his wife, who continues to haunt him, wanting him to admit the things that he did, not only on the boat, but also in their life on shore. So there's a real motif of stillness through the novel. So the doldrums is in the middle of the Atlantic, right near the equator. Nothing moves. So part two is called Death Valley because it takes place in Death Valley, which is the land equivalent of the doldrums. So,
All right.
So this is Death Valley. When the darkness begins to recede, I see the outline of a large boulder pressed against the front of the car. Smoke rises from the crunched hood, and I smell oil burning against the engine block. The digital clock on the dashboard has reset itself and blinks 12. Through the smoke, beyond the hood and rock, is the dry, endless desert of Death Valley. In the morning light, it looks just like the ocean. My ribs are tender from the impact with the steering wheel, and there is a small bump on my forehead. I turn the key in the ignition, press down on the accelerator, and the car does nothing more than make the sound of a dying cow. In the distance, I see the silhouette of a trotting coyote as he quickly leaves the scene of the accident. I step from the car to the sand and watch the sun rise over the horizon. At first, it is nothing more than a small crescent of light. The first rays paint the desert a light purple. Sand, rock, and dirt stretch in all directions like the surface of a faraway planet. Small mountain ranges change from purple to brown as the sunlight becomes stronger. My skin, too, slowly begins to brown as soon as the light hits it. The silver Lincoln town car sits useless in the desert. It looks as foreign as a flying saucer in this ancient landscape. I could wait for someone to come along, but I no longer see any road and can't remember how many miles it's been since I last left one. And if I were to be found, there would be accident reports to fill out, more officials to talk to. I take my backpack from the trunk, empty its contents on the sand, and quickly repack the necessities. Small shovel, tent, sleeping bag, two packages of dehydrated food, a box of raisins, a knife, matches, a rain poncho, and two small bottles of water. I leave the extra shirts, socks, and soap on the ground next to the car. Personal hygiene is the least of my concerns. I hadn't planned on backpacking through the desert, but I see now that it makes perfect sense. She has pushed me to this desolate landscape, to these dire doldrums far from the sea, and all that is left to do is float in this endless desert and wait for her to appear like she did so many times on the raft. I was tired and had been driving too long through the night. I should have pulled over, but I kept going, convinced I could escape by driving 80 miles per hour through the desert. I took roads at random and looked to the stars for direction. I don't know when the road ended. I remember it feeling like the boat, the car floating effortlessly on the sand, small grains hitting the quarter panels like water against the hull. I started to dream that she was beside me, putting on lipstick while looking in the visor mirror. She was wearing a white kerchief with yellow polka dots on her head, the kind worn by housewives in the 50s. She looked at me and puckered her lips. She didn't say a word as our hands met in the middle of the long seat. The car hit a rut. I was taken from my dream, and when I opened my eyes, I saw her standing in the desert. She was not the docile queen of my dreams. Instead, she stood defiantly, her hands crossed over her chest. I swerved to avoid her and hit the boulder. When I came to, she was nowhere to be seen. The pack is light, but despite its efficiency, my feet still sink in the sand as I begin walking south. I can feel the first bead of sweat on my forehead quickly evaporate and the beginnings of a painful thirst. Death Valley stretches before me like an endless sea. I look behind me at the large car and personal belongings strewn across the sand and begin to walk out into that still desert. Litterbug, she would say, and I wait for a moment to see if she does.
Wow. Really profound.
Thanks.
And some dark laughter in there, too.
Hopefully, yeah. There's some it's dark humor, I would hope.
What was the process of writing this novel like for you, going to these dark, still places?
Well, it's funny because the original short story was a comedy. It was really, really pretty funny, and it was very light. In the short story, the man leaves the life raft, but it becomes clear that everybody's going to survive and go their separate ways, and everything's going to be fine. I think once you create a plot and once you create characters, they tell the story for you once you get into that groove. For me, I was fortunate enough to have two people that I worked with at Temple that I met with every week to discuss the 10 pages that I had written, and they really helped guide me and gave me ideas. Those two people are Bill Van Wert, who sadly passed away, mm-hmm. And Alan Singer from Temple, who were just great people to work with, and they really helped me fine-tune a lot of the novel. So,
great. Well, yeah. Certainly you did everything they asked, I'm sure, because it's magnificent.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for sharing with us. What's next for you as a writer? You indicated you have something else that's a little lighter in the works.
Well, it's funny. It's I say it's lighter. I think the sentences and the structure and the characters are lighter, but really it's about murders in Kensington.
Not really light.
And I guess what I mean by light is
structure, not plot.
Yeah, structure. Certainly not content. I guess the content is darker, but the characters are a little bit lighter, and I think it's going to be easier to read. It's still difficult to write, but
So is that inspired by recent events?
It's inspired by the Kensington Strangler, certainly. Yeah.
Is that your journalism background coming into your fiction?
I do like using real events. And again, going back to what we talked about in the beginning, you take those real events and you, through fiction, you make them more realistic, for the reader, I think. I mean, mm-hmm. I think you can only get to certain truths about things like love, murder, all these different things by something that is not real. That's the way the story needs to be told of those things, I think.
So how do you juggle the life of a writer with the life of a teacher?
You get up early. And that's what I do.
Are you very disciplined as a writer?
Yeah,
then?
I think you have to be. And I think, and a lot of writers have said this and do this, you get up at 5 before anything interrupts your day. And that's what I do. I get up early and I try to write an hour and a half before my day even gets started, so that, because we're all gonna, we all have different interruptions. So that's the way I do it. Summertime's, for teachers is always good, but But one of the things that Walter Mosley said in one of his columns in the New York Times, the Writers on Writing series, is that you have to work with it every day. You know, because if it's a story, and especially if it's a novel, not so much a short story, but if it's a novel, it has to be kind of taken care of every day. You know, it's like taking care of a dog or, you know, plants or something like that. It has to be nurtured. It has to be paid attention to. If not, I think you're going to lose it. So you have to do it all year long. You never have a day off.
So do you bring that philosophy to your students as well, reminding them constantly that they should be working on papers every day? Or
for fiction students, I mean, yeah, I stress the importance of hard work. For freshman composition students, I always stress the importance of hard work, but I think freshman composition and 102 are different things where you don't necessarily have to be writing. I mean, for the semester, you do have to be writing every day. But I understand that not everybody wants to be a writer. So I kind of stress a different kind of work ethic, I think.
That makes sense.
Yeah. So.
What other advice might you have for young writers or new writers, not necessarily young, but people new to the writing world?
I'm reading John Gardner's The Art of Fiction for like the third time, and he's got good advice in there. And I think the thing that all writers would tell you is that it's really about reading, and it's about listening too. Like listening to people, listening to books that you read, and keeping an open mind about what your work can become.
Do you recommend reading aloud then, to really hear the rhythm that the author has imparted?
Of the thing that you've written, yeah. Yeah, if you want to do serious revision, then yeah, I would recommend reading out loud. Other people's novels, I think, you know, some people make the mistake of, and I do this too, but I try not to, of reading right before they go to bed. But if you're reading fiction to understand how you should write your own fiction, you should do it when you have a lot more energy and pay attention to it.
And read Marley and Me before you go to bed.
Oh, yeah, that'll make you feel like the best writer in the world. So yeah, if you want to boost the confidence, go ahead.
Great. We began our discussion tonight with the idea of words. Mm-hmm. Do you have favorite words?
Content is one of my favorite ones. Stillness is one of my favorite ones.
From the novel.
Yeah. So I like those two things.
Contentment and stillness.
Yeah.
Definitely not in the life of a writer then.
Yeah, right. We're never satisfied, so.
But that's a great thing. Mm-hmm. And not having a writer who's ever satisfied gives us more of that writer's work. So we look forward to reading your next work as soon as it's done.
Great.
Thank you so much for being with us tonight.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you, audience. Good night.